now HOD of Department of Gastroenterology of VC Hospital. He is currently the president of Society of GI Endoscopy. And I have a great pleasure in introducing Professor Matthew Philippe. He will be introducing Dr. Amit Matthew on the topic. He will conduct the proceedings. I request both Professor Gerg and Roy to be with us. At the end, we are going to take a lot of questions from the audience. I am hand over the mic to Professor Matthew Philippe.
Good evening, Dr. Chirasi.
Yes.
Thank you for your kind words. And you are a very good friend of mine. And I really appreciate for introducing this landmark series on webinars. And this is actually a big task for the people who are going to present. We have chosen the excellent people in India who are actually pioneers in their field. And I really appreciate and thank you for that. This is not only I am participating in this, but I am learning a lot from this. Because all the papers have been selected, and I especially thank Gerg for taking up the task in a different way. And he has not just taken 10 papers, but he has taken 10 issues of different aspects of pancreatitis. I really appreciate and thank him for that. And as we know that the chronic pancreatitis is actually the etiology of these various etiologies. And it has got different manifestations, starting from pain as the most important one, and also exocrine and endocrine insufficiencies. Since I belong to Kerala, where many other people believe Kerala is actually probably the capital of chronic prevalence in India, but now we know that it's all over India, it is there. And similarly, people thought initially Crohn's disease is the capital of Crohn's disease in Kerala, now we know that it's all over India, it is there. And similarly, we know that managing chronic pancreatitis, the most important issue we feel is the management of pain. And the endoscopy step in to manage either the pain or the complications of chronic pancreatitis. And the management includes pharmacological therapy, which I am sure Gerg is the leading man for that. And then comes surgical therapy. When we were students, we knew that only surgery is the ultimate treatment for chronic pancreatitis. Now we know that a major chunk is going to the endoscopist. And to that, we have an eminent man from western part of India, but known all over the world, and is a pioneer in therapeutic endoscopy. He is a surgeon by profession, but a gastroenterology endoscopist as his passion. And he is currently the chairman and chief of gastroenterology and therapeutic endoscopy at Gleneagles Global Hospital at Mumbai. And he is known for his pioneering efforts in therapeutic endoscopy all over India as well as in the world. He is a very good friend of mine, and after his master's degree, he has moved to Mecca of therapeutic endoscopy at that time in India. After PGA course, they really wanted to go to a place called Hamburg, where Nick Sohinder was there. So by the time when I reached there, Amit Mehra had already undergone a long period of training there, and I met him there once. And after he came back to India, he settled down in Mumbai and established a wonderful unit there. So he has got almost 20, more than 20 years experience in therapeutic endoscopy. And for all his work, he has been honored by the Government of India by Padma Shri in 2013. There are so many awards here, so I'm not going to tell you about that, because there are many academic. But not certain things I want to tell is about him is that he has got a special interest in therapeutic endoscopy. When we talk about blue injection in gastric lasers, the first man came is Dr. Amit Pillai. He has actually developed that glue in India. When we used to get glue from Germany, he actually made it available for common people in India. And also he has got a passion for therapeutic endoscopy, and very clearly he has shown that the management of large CVD stones, where he is an expert, and he had a lot of publications on that. And he actually stepped in for cholangioscopy and managing the large CVD stones. Then coming to his area of interest, when you hear the name, third space surgery. And he is actually instrumental in coining that term. And he has become a pioneer in third space endoscopy. And also, we know that when the new era of bariatric endotherapy came in the field, he actually stepped in. That only shows that now he is actually getting into all the areas of therapeutic endoscopy as far as possible. But he has got a passion and interest in management of chronic pancreatitis. I used to visit him many times in the past, and at that time I have seen that his interest in chronic pancreatitis management is tremendous. And I think now he is the best person for talking about the landmark papers on therapeutic endoscopy, especially the management of therapeutic endoscopy or pancreatic endotherapy. And I remember that many people studies are the most popular endoscopy teacher in India. And many of his students are actually created with me in India and abroad. So I welcome and present Dr. Amit Neeru as one of the best therapeutic endoscopy for chronic pancreatitis. Let Dr. Amit Neeru, please.
Hi, TSC. Can you hear me? Am I audible?
Yes. You are audible, yeah.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Audible, Amit. You are visible, audible.
And I would like to first of all thank Matthew for such a long introduction. You know, the issue is that when the introduction exceeds the limit of the lecture itself, then there something is going to go, something is going to happen. You know, so I'm going to be in little danger. And I have to first of all compliment TSC for having started such a fantastic webinar series. And as rightly said by Matthew, that I think you should get the prize of having the most landmark webinar series in 2020. and this is your new technique. But let me admit that as with previous other speakers, making this talk was one of the most difficult things in my life, because after a long time I did a lot of reading and a lot of studying, and I went through such a large amount of literature, and therefore I also learned a lot in this as I have prepared my talk. My talk becomes extremely difficult because I'm talking after Pramod, and Pramod has spoken so well on the various other aspects, non-endotherapy aspects of acute and chronic pancreatitis. So I will share my slides first, and then I will start my talk. So as you rightly said, TSC, every speaker of yours dealt with this topic in different ways. And therefore, even I thought of dealing with it in a little bit different way. Now, all of you are expert academicians. And quite a lot of the audience also are expert academicians. They are highly qualified gastroenterologists or maybe surgeons, whoever are watching. And all of us know that if you were to actually see what is evidence-based medicine, the various levels of evidence, you can see these are the various levels, starting from level 1A going to level 5. And of course, all of us know that the level 1A is a systematic review of properly conducted randomized controlled trials, and then this whole chart goes down to level 5, which is just an expert opinion or maybe a case report or something like that. And similarly, grades of recommendation, they correspond with the levels, so grade A, B, C and D. Now, when I went through the literature on endotherapy of chronic pancreatitis, I realized something very interesting. And what I realized is that what is the level of published literature in endotherapy of chronic pancreatitis? You see here, the type of literature which we have, everything, first of all, level is everything below 2B. From 2B to 5, we do not have 1A to 2A type of literature. And even the grades of recommendation, if you go to C, can be only in maybe grade C or grade D. Now, why is this? Why is this happening? Why is the literature of this nature? So if you see the total number of papers published on endotherapy of chronic pancreatitis, you see here only endotherapy 292, pancreatic duct strictures 4659 papers, pancreatic duct stones 3176 papers, shockwave lithotripsy for pancreatic stones 265 papers, and stenting for pancreatic strictures, 2239 papers. Now, if you were to ask a question as to why is high quality literature scant as far as endotherapy of chronic pancreatitis is concerned, after going through the whole literature, after experiencing treating patients of chronic pancreatitis for more than 25 years now, and starting my career with Professor Nip Sohendra, who came up with one of the first publications on endotherapy of chronic pancreatitis, I have sort of come to a conclusion that the reason why good quality literature is not available in endotherapy of chronic pancreatitis is, number one, is the etiology, the incidence and the pathomorphology of chronic pancreatitis is too variable. It's not very similar in various parts of the same country, in various countries in the world. Then endotherapy technique is not standardized. It's very difficult and it's very labor intensive. And if you were to go to see the overall case volumes of endotherapy of chronic pancreatitis, how many centers are actually treating pancreatic stones, pancreatic strictures, the case volumes are not too much. They're only limited to a few selected centers. Another major reason is the overall patient selection and endpoint concepts are still unclear. Even in major centers of the world, many endoscopy centers, if you go to see, the overall concept of how to select a patient, what is the endpoint of therapy, where do you stop, is still not clear. And another very important factor is ESWL, that is unavailability or inexperience of using ESWL. Well then how do I select landmark articles? Well, to select landmark articles, I think what we need to do is, you see, what I thought is, number one, it should be either a new concept which is introduced and which later became a standard of care, or it was a large prospective cohort study from a reputed center where I know that the quality of work is good. Third, it can be an endoscopy society guideline of a big country or maybe a big region or maybe a big continent. And of course, randomized trials which are comparing with existing methods like, for example, endotherapy with surgery. And so I selected such type of articles and then I chronologically organized them, and I'm going to present to you these 10 landmark articles which have spanned over the past 4 decades. So now let's go to what I'm trying to tell you. If you were to see here, so what I'm going to do is, the pioneers of endotherapy of chronic pancreatitis, if you go to see, was basically from these 5 centers of the world. And they did pioneering work in endotherapy of chronic pancreatitis somewhere from the mid-1980s, 1986 to 1991. And you see these 5 gentlemen, these 5 geniuses who actually gave a push, gave an impetus, or made a beginning in endotherapy of chronic pancreatitis. First, of course, was my teacher, Professor Nip Sohendra from the USA, Krankenhaus Eppendorf from Hamburg, Germany. Then, of course, was at the same time was Michel Kramer from the Erasmo Hospital of Belgium. And we had Kees Ubritske from the Academic Medical Center of Amsterdam. And then we had Joe Geenan from Milwaukee, University of Wisconsin. And we had Richard Kozarek from the Virginia Mason Clinic in Seattle, again in United States. Well, in the mid-1980s to early 1990s, that is from 1986 to 1991, we had these a few articles which came up from these leading centers which I call pioneers. And you see here, if you want to see these articles which were published, for example, Sohendra's article which was published in a German journal called Deutsche Medizinische Burschenschrift, which was the most famous gastroenterology journal that time, where most of the good articles were published. He gave the first description on endoscopic transpapillary drainage of the Wiersel duct in patients of chronic pancreatitis. Similarly, you see articles from Joe Geenan's group, from Kozarek's group, and you had from Michel Kramer's group, as well as from Kees Ubritske. And the conclusions which they drew, all these articles, were very interesting to read now in the year 2020. So you see here, the conclusions were like this. Pancreatic duct stenting is possible, was one conclusion. The complications are acceptable. They're around 20 to 40%, but they're acceptable. Then endotherapy should be only used for temporary purpose, and it can be a good bridge to surgery. That means if with endotherapy, by putting a stent, you find that the pain has reduced, then you can refer this patient to a surgeon. That patient will also have a good relief. And the final conclusion, for example, was this doesn't lead to acute pancreatitis. Well, this is how the whole story began. And a little later, 1989, the first landmark article was published. Why do I call it landmark? Because if you see here, this was an article published by Nick Sohandra, and it was published again in the German journal, and it was on ESWL of pancreatic stones. It was only for 8 patients where he demonstrated where these patients who had a stone predominant disease, by ESWL, he could achieve a spontaneous clearance of the pancreatic dead stones in 6 out of 8 patients. In 2 out of 8 patients, these patients required a repeat ESWL. None of the patients had serious side effects, and after 8 months when he saw, 6 out of 8 patients were pain free. Now why do I call this a landmark article? Because this was a new concept. At that time, this ESWL, just couple of years before, was launched by Sauerbruch in Germany for the treatment of gallbladder stones and bile duct stones. But it was Sohandra who first thought that ESWL should be used for pulverization of radio-opaque pancreatic stones, because I myself witnessed when I used to work with him that time, when I was from 1986 to 1991 with him, same time when this article was published, how much difficulty Nick Sohandra faced when trying to remove radio-opaque impacted stones inside the pancreatic duct. Number of procedures, invariably procedures to fail. Finally, the only thing we used to do was just place a stent and come out. And today, in 2020, we realize that ESWL has now slowly become the cornerstone of therapy in the treatment of chronic pancreatitis. Therefore, I call this as the first landmark article in endotherapy of chronic pancreatitis. 6 years later came the second landmark article, because over these 6 years, different endoscopy centers, predominantly in Europe, some centers from the United States, had already started treating patients of chronic pancreatitis by endotherapy, mainly by placing pancreatic duct stents. But at that time, the type of stent to be used, how long to keep the stent, what size of stent to use, was still not standardized. This was the first article which was published. It came from Thierry Ponchon's group from France, from Lyon, and he published it in GI Endoscopy in 1995. And the paper was called Endoscopic Stenting for Pain Relief in Chronic Pancreatitis, Results of a Standardized Protocol. So for the first time, some endoscopy showed that you should not arbitrarily place stents inside the pancreatic duct, but you should follow some standardized protocol. So what was the study? 28 patients were there. Majority of them, 90%, were alcoholic, and their main complaints were severe pain. All of them had dominant strictures in the pancreatic duct. He excluded patients who had multiple strictures, who had associated stones, who had divism, and who had biliary stricture. And what did Thierry Ponchon do? He did biliary sphincterotomy in all the patients. And his reason for doing biliary sphincterotomy was, he felt that by placing the pancreatic stent, you could occlude the biliary orifice at the ampulla greater. So he did a biliary sphincterotomy in all the patients, then performed a small 5 mm pancreatic sphincterotomy, and placed a 10 French polyethylene stent with multiple side holes in the pancreatic duct across the dominant stricture. And after that, he called the patient every 2 months, readmitted the patient, removed the stent, flushed the duct, and put a new stent. And then finally, after 6 months, that stent was removed. And then the patients were followed up. Followed at 6 months, followed at 12 months. And he found that by using this standardized protocol, he could achieve a technical success in 90%, or overall stricture resolution in 67% over 12 months follow-up, and 75% of his patients had stopped analgesics. However, around 18 to 20% patients did develop some complications like new strictures and possible new ductal changes inside the pancreatic duct, which possibly could be attributed to the polyethylene stent which he had used, the material of the stent. And to tell you the truth, the paper in 2003, after 1995, this paper, which was the first prospective randomized trial on endotherapy versus surgery, actually took the entire endoscopy community by storm. Because from early 1990s till 2000, various endoscopists from various parts of the world, predominantly in Europe, some from India, but very few from United States, had already started treating patients of chronic pancreatitis by endoscopic treatment. And they were placing stones, some of them have started doing shock wave lithotripsy, some were removing stones, various people were putting stones in different ways by using different protocols. And then this trial came up because there was a tremendous amount of resistance from the pancreatic surgeons, that endoscopists were actually wasting time, they were unnecessarily performing endotherapy, and then the patients were referred to surgery too late. Now this trial came up basically for this reason, because it came from a surgical unit from Czechoslovakia, and it was the first prospective randomized trial comparing endoscopic and surgical therapy for chronic pancreatitis. Now if you were to go to see what this trial stated, it was published in Endoscopy in 2003, 140 eligible patients, 72 of them agreed to randomization and study over 5 years. 36 were randomized for surgery and 36 to endotherapy. What is interesting to note is all the surgical procedures, almost 80% of them were resection procedures. They were not drainage procedures like lateral pancreatic or jejunostomy. And in endotherapy, majority of them stones were placed, and in only a small percentage stones were removed. ESWL that time was not followed at all in this trial, and even in patients who had stones, only stones were placed. Now the results which were measured, if you see here, the outcome measures were pain relief and further interventions. Pain relief immediately after therapy, in surgery as well as endotherapy, was good. Both were 90%, both were comparable. But this paper showed that pain relief 5 years after therapy, surgery was almost 90%, endotherapy was only 65%. If you see here, surgery failed in only 14% of the patients, whereas endotherapy failed in approximately 35% of the patients. 25% patients of surgery had a much better weight gain as compared to endotherapy, whereas diabetes, there was no difference in both the groups. So the conclusion which was reached at the end of this first prospective randomized trial was surgery was superior to endotherapy for pain relief. Let me tell you that this created a tremendous amount of commotion in all the endoscopy community of the world, and lot of articles got published, lot of letters to the editors were published, various publications in other journals, and most of the endoscopy centers which were routinely practicing endotherapy for chronic pancreatitis finally came to a conclusion that this paper could not be generalized. Why? Because this randomized controlled trial had a lot of limitations, it has pitfalls, it had a criticism. What were the main limitations, pitfalls and criticism? First of all, this was not a true randomization, it was an alternation. That means chicks were not picked up at random. Every patient was alternate. First was in endotherapy, second went to surgery, third came to endotherapy, fourth went to surgery. The surgery as well as endotherapy protocols, both of these protocols were not satisfactory. Surgery, you see here, most of the surgery was resection, it was not drainage, and endotherapy, the stones were not placed persistently in a proper fashion, and therefore a standardized protocol was not followed. The numbers of this study were too small, and there was an unequal comparison of varying morphology. So in spite of the first randomized controlled trial being published in 2003, endoscopists still persisted in doing endoscopic treatment and did not refer patients to surgery as a first line of therapy in their patients. Well, 3 years passed, and 2006, a study came from Costa Mania. Costa Mania had already published a few years before his protocol of placing multiple stents in benign biliary strictures in the bile duct. And he thought that pancreatic strictures, which were refractory, pancreatic strictures, instead of placing just one stent, they were also fibrotic strictures. Why not place multiple stents, plastic stents in the pancreatic duct? And he published this study in 2006 in Endoscopy, where he just called it as multiple stenting for refractory strictures in severe chronic pancreatitis, long-term results. He studied 19 patients who had single dominant strictures in the pancreatic duct. And the technique which he did was, he did balloon dilatation of every stricture of almost 4 or 6 millimeters. And then he placed multiple plastic stents, tried to place all the stents at one time, and tried to achieve a maximum diameter. And as if you see the stent size, the type of stents which he used were 8.5 to 11.5. So in some of his patients, inside the pancreas, there were 30 French diameter stents. And he removed these stents after 7 months. The median number of stents was 3. In some patients, he placed 5 stents. In some patients, 2 stents. Now look at his results. 3 years after removal, only 1 out of the 19 patients had a persistent stricture. 84% of his patients were asymptomatic. 10.5 patients were symptomatic stricture recurrence, but these symptoms were not much. And none of his patients had serious adverse events. However, we have to see that all these patients had post-procedure pain for a few days. That was quite expected, because suddenly you dilated the stricture up to 30 French, 40 French. And in a short, small percentage, 3%, he found some of his stents had migrated inside the duct. So the conclusion of Costa-Manius' paper was, multiple plastic stenting is feasible, safe, and promising. And endoscopist kept on pushing very hard at endotherapy. Because ESW was also becoming more and more established, and some aggressive, hardcore endoscopists had started placing stents like Costa-Manius, dilating those strictures and placing multiple stents. And then came the fifth Lambda publication, which sort of put the nail in the coffin in the endoscopist arena. And that was the second randomized trial comparing surgery versus endotherapy. Now the reason is that this trial was published in New England Journal of Medicine. And this was published by this group from the Academic Medical Center at Amsterdam. And you see here, they had 39 patients randomized. Once again, 60% of the patients were alcoholic, severe pancreatitis, severe pain, persistent pain, only 19 patients in endotherapy group, 20 patients in surgery group, but in surgery they had done a lateral pancreatic jejunostomy, not resection. Now, endotherapy, what they did was, the protocol which they followed was, they placed stents, but the stents were not long-term, short-term stents, only for a few months. They did not persist with multiple stents. And all the patients who came for endotherapy at Amsterdam, they sent for shortwave lithotripsy to Belgium. They did not do ESWL in their center. So they had no control on how the ESWL was performed. And if you were to see the surgery, lateral pancreatic jejunostomy was done. And these patients were followed up for 2 years, 24 months. And what did they see? Primary outcome was the pain score, Isbeki score. At 3 months, 6 months, 12 months, 18 and 24 months. What was the result of this randomized control trial, second randomized control trial published in any year? The results were the pain relief at 2 years, endotherapy was only 32%, surgery was 75%. Adverse events, hospital stay, pancreatic function was similar. However, the number of interventions, endotherapy were 8, surgery were 3. 2 year follow, conclusion, surgery more effective than endotherapy. Even though this was the second randomized controlled trial and surgeons thought it was a nail in the coffin for the endoscopist, but endoscopists never gave up. Endoscopists still continued to pursue endotherapy because they still maintained that even this paper has limitations. Numbers are too small, all patients are opioid dependent, 60% are alcoholic, 80% have complex morphology, stenting protocol is not complete and persistent, and ESWL was done in another country, not done in the same country where the trial was conducted. Well, endoscopic treatment continued. 2009, till that time, we had also started performing endoscopic treatment of chronic pancreatitis. It's now more than 25 years. And it was in 2009 that this very small publication came from our department. Now, why do I say that this is a landmark publication? Not because it comes from my department. Because this was the first time we showed that we could perform a large balloon sphincteroplasty in the pancreatic duct. Now this we actually performed for patients having large radiolucent strokes. For example, you see here, in this patient, we had a large dilated pancreatic duct, big stones inside the pancreatic duct, but these stones did not contain so much calcium that they could be seen on a plain x-ray, or they had a high Hounsfield units on a CT scan. So what we did is, we applied the same technique what we used to apply in the bile duct. And this was the first time in the world that we showed that we could perform a large balloon sphincteroplasty in the pancreas. Now this became landmark according to me. Why? Because this now has become the gold standard of treating patients of radiolucent pancreatic stones, which we quite commonly see in patients of tropical pancreatitis, and it is also used as an adjunct modality in patients of radio-opaque stones after pulverization and ESWL. I have to say that this study also has its limitations because the number is only 4 and it's just a case series. So therefore, I cannot really call it a landmark publication. However, I have to put it because this has become the standard of care for all patients who present with such type of a pathology. Few years later, 2011, this group did not persist from Amsterdam. They did not stop. So what they did is, the same randomized controlled trial which they had shown on in 2007, where they showed that endotherapy was superior to surgery and followed up the patients for 2 years. The same 39 patients, now they followed up for 79 months and they published this second paper which came out as a publication in Gastroenterology in 2011. And they showed long-term outcomes of endoscopic versus surgical drainage of pancreatic duct in patients with chronic pancreatitis. Now let's see what this paper says. You see here, same patients, 19 patients, 20 patients surgery, 79 months follow-up. They showed that in 79 months, additional procedures required during follow-up, 68% of the times in endotherapy was required, only 5% patients of surgery, additional procedures required. 47% of their patients of endotherapy group finally underwent surgery. And the total number of interventions over 79 months, there were 12 in endotherapy group as against 4 in surgery. And pain relief, 38% only in endotherapy group, whereas 80% in surgery. So the conclusion was very evident. Conclusion was, in 2 papers, they finally put the nail. And they finally concluded that end surgery is most effective treatment for chronic pancreatitis, whatever it is. But again, for endoscopy, the same story. The numbers were too small. Patients were having a complex pathology. The patients were same. They were alcoholics and 80% had complex pathology. And once again, the endotherapy protocol was still questionable because the stents were not kept for sufficient amount of time and sufficient number of steps. Well, there was one problem which always remained a limitation for endoscopic treatment as we progressed in the 2000s, and that was the endoscopic treatment of benign biliary strictures. Many patients who had post-chronic pancreatitis benign biliary strictures, endoscopists tried to place stents, but these strictures never responded, and we had to refer these patients to surgery, and they were called as a complex pathology. In fact, therefore, we started placing various different types of stents, and till that time, even metallic stents have come. So this study actually now came up with a real good protocol for the treatment of post-chronic pancreatitis benign biliary strictures. And this was a systematic review comparing 2 methods of stent therapy in benign biliary strictures after chronic pancreatitis, comparing fully covered expandable stent versus multiple plastic stents. You know, multiple plastic stents were shown to be very effective by Costamagna in benign biliary strictures of different etiologies except chronic pancreatitis. Chronic pancreatitis strictures never responded to multiple plastic stents. So, if you, this study actually tells us why. You see here, comparison between fully covered stents versus multiple plastic stents, 99 relevant studies included, 12 studies of fully covered stents and 13 studies of multiple plastic stents. Technical success of fully covered stent was 100%, plastic stent was 98%, similar. But if you see, clinical success of fully covered stents was 77%, whereas multiple plastic stent was only 33%. And mean number of procedures of fully covered stent was only 3, multiple plastic stent 17 mean number of procedures. Mean duration was also similar. The conclusion was, if you have a post-chronic pancreatitis benign biliary stricture, fully covered metal stents are distinctly superior to multiple plastic stents. So this is the study which finally tells us how now to treat benign biliary strictures because of chronic pancreatitis. After all this literature which was published, 2 randomized controlled trials or 3 randomized controlled trials, 1 long-term study trial by various people, finally, European Society guidelines came out in 2014-2019 I am going to tell you only the updated guidelines in 2019, which finally came up with some conclusions for endoscopists to follow. Because every endoscopy center was following their own technique. They were following their own way of treating chronic pancreatitis. So the main recommendations which came from ESGE in 2019 were endoscopic treatment and or ESWL for chronic pancreatitis should be considered as the first line of therapy for painful, uncomplicated chronic pancreatitis with obstruction of LPD in the head and body. It's important to see this. Uncomplicated chronic pancreatitis. So they have left out complex disease and obstruction of the head and body. So they have left out tail strokes. When radiopaque stones more than 5 millimeters, you should always start by ESWL. Don't do ERCP. So first ESWL, pulverize the stone and then do ERCP. And what was the protocol which they said for painful dominant PD strictures? A 10 French plastic stent you should place at least for 1 year, do a 6-monthly imaging. And after 1 year when you remove the stent, if the stricture persists, you should give the patient the choice to put multiple plastic stents or surgery. Not directly start placing multiple plastic stents. And they also wrote that for post-chronic pancreatitis benign biliary strictures, in spite of that systematic review which came a few years before, ESG still maintained in these guidelines that you had a choice whether to place a fully covered stent or to place multiple plastic stents. And finally, in 2020, we came back to square one. We started with the first publication of Nip Sohendra, who told us that ESWL should be the beginning of endotherapy of chronic pancreatitis. And in 2020, came the 10th landmark publication, The Success of ESWL and ERCP in Symptomatic Pancreatic Stones, a systematic review and meta-analysis. You see here, 486 studies were screened, 22 studies included, and results of the pooled data was complete duct clearance of the ESWL and ERCP to be achieved in almost 70% of the patients, complete absence of pain during follow-up in 65%, complete stone fragmentation in 86%, and all this you can achieve with a relatively low adverse events, 4% of pancreatitis and 0.5% of cholangitis. Well, therefore, as I come to the end of my talk of 10 landmark publications, then what message can I give to the audience who is going to watch? After watching all this, after reading the entire literature, going through each and every paper, and after my own experience of almost 28 years of treating chronic pancreatitis, the take-home message which I will give is, number one, when you want to treat patients of chronic pancreatitis by endotherapy, you should have a proper patient selection. Non-alcoholic etiology, you should select. And if your patient is alcoholic, select a non-complex pathomorphology. A patient should not be opiate addiction. Ideally, head and body disease, whether it is stone or stricture. Patient compliance is very important. If your patient is not ready to stop alcohol, not ready to stop smoking, or not ready to come back for repeated procedures and follow-up, don't enroll the patient for endotherapy. Simple pathomorphology. Ideally, a stone predominant disease, single dominant stricture, and a dilated duct. Duration of symptoms, ideally less than 5 years. Intermittent episodes of pain, not continuous repeated pain. Take home message 2, pre-procedure workup. You should always do a fluoroscopy on an X-ray and detect radiopaque stones by location, density, and volume. MRCP becomes an extremely important investigation to see the ductal morphology. You see the duct size, strictures, pseudocyst and biliary stricture. And CT scan will tell you the HF units, the Hounsfield units. I'll tell you one thing. Ideal for ESWL is anywhere between 400 to 800 Hounsfield units. Anywhere above 800 Hounsfield units, the stones is not going to break with shockwave lithotripsy. And you are going to need something else or surgical treatment. And CT also to see for SOL. And of course, other investigations like blood investigations and overall performance index. And of course, take home message 3 for pancreatic stones. All radio-opaque pancreatic stones, more than 5 of them, ESWL first before ERCP. End point of ESWL, pulverize the stones to less than 3 mm size. Radio-opaque stones less than 5 mm with a dilated duct, direct ERCP. All radiolucent stones, direct ERCP with balloon filtroplasty. Follow up your patient every 3 months. and then repeat ESWL and ERCP until end point is achieved. Temporary 5.7 pin stone in 15 sessions, and end point of therapy for pancreatic stone should be complete clearance of the duct, not just placing the stent. Very, very important. That is the takeoff. And finally, treatment of pancreatic strictures. If the stricture is possible, place the largest possible stent in the first sitting itself. If 10 prints is not possible, repeat every month until you put at least 2 10 print stents. Then follow the ESG protocol. Call after 1 year, intervene, and then decide whether you want to do multiple stents or a surgery. Of course, in delayed strictures and pseudocyst, I will prefer to use a fully covered expandable stents rather than multiple plastic stents. And pseudocyst, we place a trans-papillary stent. So when to stop endotherapy is very, very important. After endpoint is achieved, complete stone clearance and patient stent, pain-free for 6 months, stricture resolution, and patient intermittently symptomatic during endotherapy with repeated visits. You have to investigate for complex pathology or malignancy. And you see here, if after 3 years of endotherapy, you don't see an endpoint in sight, you have to send the patient for surgery. These are the final take-home messages which I would like to tell you. And with this, I would like to end my talk. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you, Amit Mehra, for this excellent talk and very clear presentation. And thank you again for this take-home message as well. Yes, what's next? Sound is not good.
Mute. Yeah, mic is muted. How much time did you take to prepare this?
It took me 15 days.
Okay. It was as possible as extracarpal shock or lithotripsy. And it was as effective as extracarpal shock or lithotripsy. We have been taken into kind of a journey where you put a lot of your efforts. At the end of it, you gave a take home message so clear cut that is possible. Even had you read alone, would not have been possible. Not only you have read, you have experienced the journey yourself for the last 28 years or 30 years. You will not calculate your age. Tell me 30 years or 35 years?
30 years of practice, but pancreatitis we started after we got ESWL in 1998.
Now I know your age now. You are class 68. Anyway, I will be thoroughly enjoyed. It's as much as what I enjoyed promote Gerg's the talk, it's also a very complicated thing. And despite his busy schedule, he made it so nice and take home message. And the endotherapy, you started in a different way. Surgeon is the best. But how endotherapy can, and you were like a roller coaster in this one kind of journey. Initially endotherapy, then surgery, endotherapy, surgery. And let me start with the question to both the speakers before I call upon Dr. Jayanti. We have 120 questions here now.
Wow.
Select some questions from which is very relevant. At the same time, I group the question in such a way. Most of the journal articles, what you presented, landmark publications. This is both to Pramod and Amit. They are from New England Journal of Medicine. What is your take?
Pramod, you answer first.
Because that is why it is considered the best journal, you know. It has been there for more than 200 years, and that is the reason it has an impact factor of more than 70 now. So obviously, something which changes the game, then the editors know that. And the paper that Amit presented on the surgery versus endoscopic therapy, you see, the sample size was 39.
Mm.
I mean, you send a paper to JGH or any other journal, will reject it.
Mm.
And with the sample size of 39, any journal published it because it changes the game. So the editor of the journal are very smart people. They know the worth of a paper. And that is why majority of such trials are published in any journal.
In fact, my second question was like that only.
the sample size is so small, how will a leader in the publication, medical scientific publication, could accept it? I think that the answer is very clear.
I mean, I think more than that, more than the changing of game, because I will not fully agree with Pramod that it changed the game. Because there were a lot of criticism, in spite of being published in any journal, lot of criticism. I think that paper was published in any journal because it was the first randomized trial on a subject which was never tackled from that perspective. Now, whenever you say it was a prospective randomized trial and on a topic which is a hot topic, because there were a lot of discussion was going on that time in the world between endoscopists and surgeons. And that time, if you publish a paper, it's going to come.
Okay, my second question to both the speakers. A lot of youngsters are watching this, a lot of postgraduates. What is your advice to both of, to these people, when you want to create a landmark publication, how they should choose and how they go about?
First of all, take pancreatology as your career.
But you are there, boss, already.
No. So that is very important. There are so many people doing endoscopy, this and that, but I'm telling you, they should take pancreatology, very tough subject.
Okay.
Liver is a tough subject, but there are so many people in liver now.
Okay.
So pancreas also needs many people to understand the complex pathophysiology of the disease, which you don't. Right?
Okay.
So that is one.
So you mean to say you travel the road, choose the road less traveled by others. Okay.
Absolutely right.
Number one.
Second is be consistent.
Okay.
Tomorrow you go to a conference, TSC and Amit Medhe will perform complex procedures, people will clap and they say, oh, I have to do this. This is the way. No. Don't do that. Do it, but follow, be consistent with your aim.
Okay.
Third, make a longitudinal cohort with you. Once you accumulate a longitudinal cohort of patients with a particular disease, you start understanding the disease much better. And then you raise questions. I am seeing this, this is not written. I am reading this, this is not seen in my patients. That will lead you to the relevant research question. And then you try and answer. So you choose the field, be consistent, develop a longitudinal cohort, raise questions based on what you read and what you observe. You find discrepancy, that's your research question. Then answer it. That's the way to go.
Amit, your take.
What was your question exactly?
Yeah. What is your advice to youngsters to have landmark publications?
To have landmark publications.
Mm. See, what the speakers had one landmark publication in your series. I'm very glad that we have such eminent people in India. We are very proud of you. You had that spintroplasty and you had that the article in when you presented landmark publication. So we are fortunate to have you. So you are the right people to advise the juniors. So what is your take?
Well, my take on it is either it has to be a technique related issue. So try to do something. For example, I'll tell you what, it's a difference between swimming in the swimming pool and deep sea. In the deep sea, there is no competition. In the swimming pool, there is a lot of competition. So, if you do something where many people are doing, so you have to do something different. So, you keep a continuous inquisitive mind. Even in your day-to-day practice, all the time ask the question why. Keep an inquisitive mind. And I have a feeling that what Pramod also said, every patient which comes to you should enter into some protocol or the other for some study. Every patient. And at the end of say few years, you will suddenly realize that you have got so much data that on that you can get so much meaning. And if you keep on asking questions to yourself that I am doing a particular way in this particular way, but this is a need, how can I change it? Can I do it in a different way? And of course, for publication, I already showed you the levels of evidence. Don't just keep on publishing case reports. You can begin with that, but try to do something better. Large cohort study, okay. Yeah.
I got 2 points to tell them. Summarize, travel in a road which has not been traveled by others and don't keep changing your roads. And you are telling that you swim in the sea.
Yeah.
Even if you don't have a sea like in Delhi, but still you managed to do so. So this is the message. Now while I am sorting out the question, may I ask Professor Jayanti to give a comment. This is an expert comment from Jayanti. Jayanti has been in the field for more than how many years, I don't know. Since I have seen her, she has been a gastroenterologist. And the one thing has not changed with Jayanti is the kind of enthusiasm in updating knowledge and propagating knowledge. And all the postgraduate, they always consider her as the ma to deliver the gastroenterology. And she is a prolific writer, published from this part of the country. We are very proud to have you, Professor Jayanti. And now, mic is to you.
Thank you, Dr. Tracy, for those very kind words. I'm actually a jack of all trades, you know. So I'm neither a pancreatologist, neither a hepatologist, nor a gastroenterologist. My field is wide because we belong to those years when research was just at its infancy. So I think the audience would all agree that we had a wonderful session with two stalwarts in the field of pancreatology, Dr. Pramod Garg, who brought us through the various concepts. He actually went down the memory lane on how the concept of beginning pancreatitis came in, the role of early ERCP. Then he brought in the interesting concept of the severity score of Balthazar's, which changed the concept of the severity score in management of patients. And very interesting was the persistent organ failure, which he alluded to. I think that was a very important message that he conveyed, along with necrosis, which occurs in more than 50% of patients if they do have a persistent organ failure. I hope I'm right, Dr. Pramod, in that interesting. And then from there on, he moved on to the necrosis, which can be sterile, but it could be infected. And then while the surgeons were taking over the infected the necrosis, became the concept where endotherapists moved in. And today there is a different role of endotherapists in the management of patients with infected necrosis, and the results are almost more gratifying, with more than 60% outcome compared to the surgical. I think that was the basic summary of the current stages of management. And very nicely, I like the way he brought in the recent concept, but actually all these things have taken place much, much earlier. So he could bring in the two together and combine the two and brought in all the aspects of management of acute pancreatitis. And when he came down to chronic pancreatitis, Dr. Balakrishnan's paper on, we always used to read about TCP, tropical calcium pancreatitis. Mohan Vishnathan and I all worked on this TCP along with Suresh Chari. And then came Dr. Pramod Garg's paper where we introduced the word of idiopathic chronic pancreatitis. So, and then of course, the concept of smoking alcohol is in the basic course was alluded to by him, and then it switched over to genetic concept, and very well brought out. And now we have Indian studies to say that SPINK1 gene may be one of the factors for chronic pancreatitis. I think that was a summary of Dr. Pramod Garg's paper. But Dr. Matthew and Dr. Rai, would you like to add on something to Dr. Pramod Garg's session that he had?
I think as I told my introduction, I like the concept of bringing up group of papers in certain areas and then bringing the idea of presentation. But rather than selecting 10 papers, because you know that the concept of introduction of genetics was not confined to only one paper, because different areas of the world have different outcomes. And also in the first paper on letters of chronic pancreatitis, then the spectrum of chronic pancreatitis is what he has narrated the story of Dr. T. Venkis. Actually, I knew about that book and how hardship he had made to make that book and to collect the data at that time, you know, 1960s, and to make a data like that is very difficult. But I think he has actually brought from the past and then came down the latest things. And I really think that he has put a lot of efforts to make that data, and it was so great and wonderful.
We have several questions to go take up, so I would like you, all of you, to be brief and to the point. Jayanti madam, Jayanti, you are going to comment on the second paper.
So, and topic. Dr. Amit went very nicely through the decades, you know, from the 1990s down to 2020, and it was all the concept. I think overall, In a nutshell, it was initially the management of pain, where the surgeons had a major role, and that randomized control trial continued much later, till the almost to the end, when they did not give up and they continued, their surgeons didn't have a role. And then there was a changing concept of the management of strictures and the concept of management of radio-inducing stone versus the radio-opaque stones. And of course, the definite role of the biliary stents in patients with biliary stricture. I think very well discussed, and I really like the summary, the last four slides, which really summarized the entire concept of endotherapy in management of, I think if the postgraduates are able to just understand and pick up that, I'm sure they will really be able to tailor their management in patients which they come across with chronic pancreatitis. I think that would be my summary of Dr. Ali.
Wonderful. Professor Jayanti, you said you are neither a pancreatologist nor endoscopist.
Not a hepatologist.
But you gave a very nice commentary on the Abhodha subject, and thank you very much for your nice comment. Now I will start taking the lot of comments first to Dr. Pramod Garg and Dr. Anil, and the comments